bioregenerative life support, I think, has allowed the whole area of space development, exploration, and space efforts in general to engage with biology in a more intimate way, in the sense that they could use biology ultimately for life support systems for humans as they go farther into space. So I think it's been an interesting way of connecting biology with aerospace engineering efforts, and kind of merging two communities that maybe didn't always have a natural connection before that. So I think it has enabled some very interesting and synergistic relationships. Bioregenerative life support has evolved a lot over the past 20 and 30 and even 40 years. And the concepts go actually even farther back than that. It's probably been one of the most enduring areas of biological research for space, even going back to the beginning of some of the early space programs. And so in the 1980s, there was an expansion of efforts. I worked for NASA, and NASA expanded a lot of their research in this area. And it focused largely on controlled environment production of crops. So using growing plants in chambers where they you can control the light, the temperature, the watering, things like that, to really get high yields and push the crops to generate lots of biomass, to produce lots of oxygen. And at that time, it was focused largely on field crops, things like wheat, potatoes, sweet potatoes, soybeans. And so that was a major thrust in the 1980s and 1990s. And those efforts were focused largely on when we might get to another planetary surface, like the moon or Mars. Now, those interests are still there. In NASA's case, they've begun to focus more on near-term missions, meaning the space station, maybe a Mars transit mission. That's when you travel to Mars, or even when you first get to a surface setting. And so they're focused more on food crops that could provide very nutritious supplements to the diet, and that could provide dietary diversity, you might say, because the astronauts right now are dependent entirely on stored stabilized foods, packaged foods. So that's sort of the thrust now. So there's been sort of a moving area of focus over that time. And it has, even from the beginning, been largely an international effort. And so, as I say, I work for NASA, but the European Space Agency has had interests in this area. The Russian Space Agency for many years, the Japanese Space Agency, the Chinese Space Agency now, the Chinese National Space Agency, Canadian groups, German groups through the DLR Space Agency. So there have been lots of changes. And throughout that time, there have been lots of scientific findings and papers that have been published. I think the challenges for bioregenerative life support are some of the same ones we've faced in the past. For space systems, you're always constrained by the mass you have to launch into space, the power that you need, the electrical power, for example, the volume that you need, and also the crew time. That means how much time do you demand on the astronauts, for example, to keep things running. And so these have been long-standing challenges. They still exist, so we need to continue to improve, to reduce the power, the energy needs, reduce the mass, reduce the volume. We have new tools now that we can use to develop better crops. We can miniaturize technologies now much better than we could 20 years ago, say, for example. We can maybe even begin to think really seriously about more automated systems where we can reduce the amount of and the need for the astronauts' time. So I think these are challenges. I think on a fundamental side, we really haven't had the opportunity to test the effects of true space environments on some of these systems as they operate. For example, how does radiation affect the plants? Plant systems have their own microbiota in the roots and on their leaves. How does radiation affect those the living plants? If we do it in reduced gravity, how does that affect things? There are engineering challenges to do. Water doesn't drain as well under reduced gravity. And in weightlessness, water doesn't drain at all. So watering plants is always a challenge. So I think there are lots of fascinating problems that are still ahead of us, and I'm hopeful we can continue to do research in those areas.